thanks for coming. So as you can see, I'm going to give the standard disclaimer that I give to any time I do a presentation about astrophotography, which is that I actually have no idea what I'm doing. Unlike you smart guys, I am just a lawyer, and I'm not one of those smart lawyers that is like a patent lawyer that is basically just an engineer who decided to go to law school. I have an undergraduate degree in economics, and I do antitrust law, look at companies and run the economics and figure out whether they should merge. So I honestly have no technical background whatsoever. So if I do get the occasional nice picture, it is definitely more through stubbornness rather than through any technical skill. The advantage for you guys, other than desperation, if you're looking at me for advice, we know that the problem is. The advantage for you guys is, if I can figure out how to do this, you definitely can. Whenever I do one of these talks about astrophotography, I call it "You suck at astrophotography," and so do I, for exactly that reason. Because if you're listening to me, we know that there's some challenges here already. This is the volume 4, which is shooting with your eyes closed, and what I'm going to talk about is automation. The challenge with astrophotography is it's kind of time consuming, and it takes up a lot of your sleeping time, right? But over the last few years, we've gotten new software that will run with the existing hardware that makes the whole process a lot easier. You can actually sleep, do other things, and your computer and all your hardware will basically run themselves while you're doing that. I'm going to walk you through. I'm going to talk about Sequence Generator Pro. That's the software that I use that runs all this. But most of what I'm going to do is talk about the different components that you need. There are other software packages that you can use to tie all this together to make your system run. What I really want to focus on is the components of the system. At the end, I'll set up one of the sequences I use with Sequence Generator, and I'll walk you through it, and you can see how Sequence Generator would control all this hardware that you've got set up. Okay. So the reason I put this lovely picture here, which is not quite so lovely on this projector, is that I was not awake when this image was captured. It's three different colors, three different filters, shot over, I don't know, four or five nights, I think, over the winter. I was asleep when the telescope turned and pointed to it. I was asleep when the telescope started taking the pictures. I was asleep when the telescope finished taking the pictures and put itself to bed for the night. And I woke up in the morning, went out to the observatory, got my laptop, and the pictures were all there waiting for me. This is to demonstrate to you that I am not a high-end kind of imager. This is my observatory. You'll see that once you roll it back, it really is just this little doghouse. And all my equipment is inside there. A few years ago, when I finally got tired of wheeling my SCP around my yard on a dolly and having to set it up and pretty much break it down every night, I started laying out plans to build a roll-off roof observatory right in this little spot right in here. And my wife said to me, "That's fine as long as you have an 8-foot-tall hedge in place before the observatory gets built, because we don't want anyone on the street to see that eyesore, right?" And rather than waiting 10 years for the 8-foot-tall hedge to grow, I said, I sat and I rethought the project, and I thought, I don't really necessarily need to climb inside there with my telescope. All I need is a place that my telescope can stay permanently set up. So the skybox, which really is basically just a doghouse that rolls away. And you'll see that my observing location is wonderfully illuminated by a streetlight about 75 feet in the distance. But when you roll it away, it all fits inside there. So this took maybe a week of work to set up, and is the my high-end imaging setup. Let me walk you through some of the equipment that's here. The doghouse is pretty self-explanatory, and is really not involved in automation. I'm doing up in the red field, I'm doing the same kind of thing that I do at home. I have the same hardware, same software, just you know, set up under a nice silver tarp that blows around in the wind as opposed to in the doghouse. Let me walk you through the different hardware that you're going to need to do automated imaging. And the wonderful thing that you'll see is that most of it is free, right? You don't have to pay anything for most of the stuff. The camera, the telescope, the mount, they're all free. Free in the sense that you've already paid for all that stuff anyway. At least you paid for the telescope and the mount. If you haven't paid for the camera, that's actually a prerequisite for astrophotography. Yeah, well, that's true. We're talking to a lawyer. Auto-guider, if you're going to need the auto-guider anyway, if you're going to do astrophotography. Off-axis guider, maybe have a guide scope, that kind of thing. All of those are kind of the entry requirements for astrophotography anyway. So the only thing that you're really going to add to this is you're going to do the USB filter wheel, and which is this component right here. And the reason you have a USB filter wheel is because you need something that's automated so that your filters will get rotated in at appropriate times during the night by the software. Now, if you're using a color camera, forget the filter wheel. You don't need the filter wheel at all, right? Second thing that you will need one way or the other, or at least, okay, technically don't need that either. If you feel like you don't need to refocus during the night, you don't need an autofocuser. If you feel like you do need to refocus during the night, you do need an autofocuser. When I first started looking into this whole automation business 2-3 years ago, I asked on cloudy nights, you know, what is involved in autofocusing? You know, there was a thread already going from somebody who was asking this question of, what do I need to do autofocusing? You know, do I really need to autofocus? Do I really need to refocus during the night? And somebody sat and did the calculations for him and laid out the motor he would need, the motor controller he would need, the software he would need, and the automation software he would need to interface with all this, added up all the math and came up with like $1,299 to autofocus. At which point I posted back, thank you so much for making clear to me that I do not need to refocus during the night. It's not necessarily at all. However, since then, after doing some of my own digging, I discovered that there actually are much cheaper ways to do it. So the autofocuser I use is from Rigel Systems, and it's this component right in here. So this is the motor, and it just rides on the standard SCT stock focuser here. You see that there's a white gear that's added here, and a gear that runs off the motor. And then, can't see it in this package, but there's a tiny little, I don't know, it looks almost like a thumb drive that a few things plug into. And what it does is it will receive commands from the automation software and refocus during the night. I'm going to walk you through a little bit about how automatic focusing works, because it is pretty cool. It really gave me a geekish thrill the first time I saw it run all by itself. I wasn't asleep, because I'm not going to trust it right away. But seeing how it worked, it actually was kind of cool. But the deal is, this costs $320, which is, you know, not pocket change, but it's not $1,299 either, right? And compared to the cost of the already sunk costs for astrophotography, it really did not seem like much. The last component is the software that holds all this together. I use sequence generator, which costs $99. There are definitely more expensive ways to do this. But my point here is kind of show you my low-end setup and give you an idea what the entry cost is to get into automated imaging. And so you can see the total cost is $639, except for the little asterisks down here. The asterisk is that the USB filter wheel, if you need one, actually costs $360. This is an Orion Nautilus filter wheel. I use 1 1/4 inch filters. This has 7 of them. I think they also have a 5-slot or 4-slot 2-inch filter wheel, which is about the same price. And you can get, there's a couple other filter wheels you can get. Attic has one, Starlight Express has one for roughly the same amount of money. But the point here is that, yes, it costs does cost $360, but if you have a manual camera, you're going to need a filter wheel anyway. Cheapest filter wheels that I've seen right now are about $150. And that actually is what I used to have. I used to have the manual filter wheel from Orion. The extra cost to have the whole system automated, by my calculations, is $639. And given how much money you've sunk already into your telescope mount, camera, auto-guided camera, $639 that allows you to sleep while your images are being taken, money well spent. Why do we automate our images? Probably any of you have already done it, probably already know why you want to automate your imaging. But this is what happened before. I would run outside. So remember, I'm permanently set up, right? So I don't even have to set up. But I still find myself running in and out of the house. I have to run out to roll the thing back, get everything set up. Then I have to find my target, so slew around with the scope for a little while. Then I used a Botnov mask. You guys know what a Botnov mask is? It's basically just a little plastic disc with slits in it. You put it in front of your objective, in front of your objective lens, or in front of your corrector plate, and it helps you focus. But it's manual, right? You're doing that to get it focused. And you're going back and forth, and the sky is wobbling around, and like what looked like it was focused the first time you did that doesn't, and you keep going back and forth, and eventually you get focused. Then I would set my filter in place, then I would start imaging, and I would actually go inside and I would set an egg timer to remind me, okay, the hour for that filter is up. Then it would be time to run back outside, repeat steps 3, 4, and 5, in other words, focus again, set the next filter, start imaging, run back inside, set the egg timer again for the next filter. Repeat that for all the filters, so if you're doing LRGB, you're doing that at least 4 times during the night, maybe more, if you want to do blue on each side of the meridian. Once my target would go into the trees, because I only have a 3 or 4 hour window from my house, once my target would go into the trees, I would have to do it all over again for the next target. Slew the telescope to the target, find the target, which, given the narrow field of view on my telescope is not always easy, do all that all again. Then, when I finally say, okay, now I'm just going to let the telescope run for the rest of the night, go to bed, and hope that when I wake up in the morning, the telescope isn't, ground into the ground. Because remember, my rig is that. And so, if I go to bed, notice my peer is that tall, right? So if I go to bed, I can come out in the morning and find that the telescope has slewed all the way around and is grinding itself against the base of these boards here. Not something that you really want to find. So that's what the praying disaster doesn't strike during the night. And the other thing that I found, I don't know if you guys all run into this problem, but I image from my home, and the reason I call it the hole in the trees is because I really do only have a 3 or 4 hour window. I have almost no western sky at all. So I can image from about 40 degrees, 45 degrees up in the east until maybe 1 hour past the meridian. So if I only have 3 or 4 hours on a target, but I have, say 12 hours of darkness in the deepest, darkest winter, I'm losing, 6, 7, 8, 9 hours of imaging time that I could otherwise image during, unless I want to stay up until 5 o'clock in the morning, which I'd really rather not. So this is what I would run into. So that's my 11-step checklist. And after a while of doing this, you are going to wind up looking like this guy. And that is your goal, to avoid looking like that. At least your family will, assuming that they remember what you look like at all, considering how much time you've been spending running in and out to the telescope. So with automation, all you do, literally, is go out, roll the lid back, point the telescope up at the sky. I do have to focus. Let me back up. Point the telescope up at the sky, as in point it there, that's good enough, because I don't have to point it at anything in particular. Then I get, a rough focus. You don't have to focus super accurately. And there are programs that you don't have to focus at all. Sequence generator doesn't do this, but there are programs that you can set up that will literally do the entire focusing process for you. But for me, go out, roll the doghouse back, point the telescope up to the sky, roughly focus on whatever happens to be in the telescope field of view at that point, press the go button, go inside and go to sleep. Because all of this stuff is set in advance. Yeah?
Do you select your objects?
Yeah, so what I've done, and I'll walk you through this at the end, you set up what's called, sequence generator calls it a sequence. If you're involved in satellite imagery, you would call this a task order. It is a list of targets that I want to hit during the night. It's a list of filters that I want to use on those targets. It's got all the information. So you've set up a script in advance that it will, the program will walk through and it'll run your hardware through during the night while you are asleep. It'll take care of all this stuff for you.
So that comes under setup, in other words.
Yes, that's true. There is definitely a programming the system in advance.
Right.
And you can do it years ahead of time if you want. Yeah. And in fact, I'm trying to get myself disciplined enough that I have my sequences set up. But on Friday night, I was typing information into sequence generator to set things up. But you can, you really should, because you are programming a computer, and there, it does want a lot of information from you, because you got all this hardware that it's supposed to run for you, right? And you need to tell it what to do with each of those pieces of hardware. So you do want to, ideally you want to spend some time ahead of time sitting and, entering all this information into the program and checking it and making sure that, as it goes through, yeah, it's going to do that, it's going to do the right thing, it's going to be pointing at the right targets. Especially if you're like me and you've got trees all over your sky that you've got to avoid. Otherwise, you will do what I occasionally do, which is come out to the telescope in the morning and wonder why it is still pointed up at the sky, or wonder why it is parked, but it only acquired your first target and not the second and third target. And the reason is because I entered the times wrong, my target ran into the trees. So you do have to that definitely is a step that you have to do. You have to set up the information in advance. But the advantages though are you don't have to be there while it's going on. I think I've probably hit that a fair amount, that you can do whatever you want. I mean, so what I did on Friday night was I wandered around. Well, as Chris will say, I spent a lot of time cursing at my mount trying to wonder why it was blowing around in the wind. But automation is not going to solve that problem for you. Wrenches may solve that problem for you. Counterweights may solve that problem for you. But automation, no, not so much. But when it was running, I spent my time looking through Chris's dob, wandering around the field, looking through your giant dobs, things like that. When I'm at home, I'm inside, and my wife and kids are no longer saying, "Why are you spending so much time outside at your telescope?" Second advantage, which is really important for me, like I said, I only have a 3 or 4 hour window. And if I want to use 10 or 12 hours of darkness, I'm going to have to hit multiple targets during the night. This, to me, is the coolest thing of automation. And I will walk you through how this actually works when I set up sequence generator for you. But I'm still amazed at the idea that I will go to bed, my telescope will continue working on the target that I told it to start with. When that runs into the trees at, say, 2 o'clock in the morning, it'll say, "Oh, time to go to the next target." Will actually find it all by itself, start taking the pictures, do the same thing with the third target during the night, and when I come down in the morning, they're all sitting there on the laptop waiting for me to look at. The other thing is it's safe. So I've told you, there were times beforehand that I would come and find that my scope had slewed all the way around, the dew cap had popped off, and the scope was pointing at the board at the bottom of my observatory. If you have dumb mount, one of the things that you probably run into, at least if you have a long refractor on a gem mount, you are probably aware of the risk of it crashing into the mount after a meridian flip, right? The other thing, it won't point at the sun. I mean, your scope will be safely put to bed by your system at the end of the night. what I do is I park my scope. In fact, so in this position, this is the park position for my scope. And you can't see any of this from here, but I actually, at the back of the doghouse here, I have a white foam core panel. And I have lights on the inside edges here, and an electronic timer that I just plug into to my power outlets, set it to turn on at a particular time. And then when the targets are finished for the night, generally at dawn, or morning twilight, the scope will park itself, be pointing directly at that flat panel, the lights will come on, and then the automation software will tell it to take flat images against that flat panel. So all of this stuff is waiting for me in the morning. I'll walk you through a little bit about flats. There's a different way to do flats that other programs will run. But you know, all that stuff is done for me, and I've taken biases ahead of time. If you have darks, you've taken those ahead of time. So that stuff is all set. But flats you really need to take every session, or at least I certainly do. All of this stuff is taken care of. Your scope has settled down to the night, for the night. Another thing for me, another reason that I wanted to park it. In fact, this is how I first got into automation. I first was interested in automation, not for all moving the filter wheel, finding multiple targets, all that kind of stuff. All I really wanted was I wanted to make sure my scope was safe in the morning. And I didn't want to go outside in the morning and find it pointed up, as a inviting target for a passing bird. Or more important for me, I have tall tulip poplars in my backyard. And in midsummer on hot days, they actually put out a little mist. And while I'm imaging at night, I don't think much of that happens at night. But when it starts to warm up in the morning, this little mist starts to come down. And you come in, you look at your corrector plate, and you've got these tiny little dots on it. And I wanted to try and minimize that. So I was really looking for just something to park my scope at night. And that's why I first ran into sequence generator. But as I have added components to my system, filter wheel, multiple targets, all of those kind of things, I've been able to add those capabilities as I've gone on. But that's really all I started into it for, was please park my scope so nothing bad happens to it in the morning. Or it's pointed, slewed into the ground, that kind of thing. So I wanted to avoid both of those things. And as I've said, the huge advantage is you can sleep while imaging. I mean, we know that it's thrilling to go out and look at the dark sky, a little bit less so from my house because I live half a mile outside the Beltway, sandwiched in between the Dunloring Metro Station and Tyson's Corner Mall. So,
wow.
There's some stuff to see, but it's not exactly a place that you'd say, wow, visual observing from around here is a lot of fun. So, sleeping is a good thing to do. So these are the different components that I'll walk you through. But in general, there are five different components that your automation software is going to run, because each of these things is doing something during the night, and it's going to need to get commands from the automation software to make that all happen. I'm going to walk through them one at a time. Actually, I've already told you a little bit about my imaging setup. A couple of the other components that go into this that don't really have anything to do with automation. I use the ASI as my autoguider. That's also a planetary camera. And the main reason I got it was for planetary imaging, but it's actually an excellent auto-guiding camera as well. The SXVR, the cost of automation compared to the cost of the telescope and the SXVR is really small. It's really nothing to worry about at all. The filter wheel we already talked about, off-axis guider, is actually, I replaced my off-axis guider, that's my new one. I was using a Taurus tracker until a couple months ago. This one allows me to rotate 360 degrees around. The Taurus did the same thing, but the way that some of the geometry on the Taurus worked was I would run into my focus motor before I'd be able to rotate 360 degrees. So this one is actually a little bit more convenient for me. Autofocuser we talked about, I have a reducer in there, and the scope. So like I said, compared to the scope and the camera, all of this stuff is cheap. I want to walk through the components one by one and give you an idea of what they're doing during the night and what your automation software has to do with them. So your mount obviously is tracking during the night, but while you might think, well, you know, my autoguider is running, my mount is taken care of, what does the automation software have to do with it? There are actually several points during the night where your automation software will intervene. There's a lot of move, a lot of stop commands, things like that. I told you that when I go out, I point at a random part of the sky, right? I mean, what I do is I have a target set in my Celestron software that says, just go to the meridian and the equator. So in other words, I'm not going to any particular target, and I just use that to focus on, and then I press the start button on my automation software. And it will slew to the first target from there. We'll talk about plate solving and how it figures out how it does that. But this is one of those points where I've got auto guiding up and running because I use PhD, so I've already got PhD running in the background. And so to slew to targets, either to the first target or to the second and third target during the night, the automation software has to send a command to the mount to stop taking auto guiding commands. To settle and to slew over to the next target. It does relay the commands from the autoguider. At least most automation software has that role as well. Dithering. I didn't actually ask this question when we got started. How many of you guys already take images? So dithering is your autoguider has got a star. You know, whether you're using an off-axis guider or whether you're using a guide scope. Your auto guider is looking at a star while your imaging camera is taking pictures. But your imaging camera has hot pixels in it, it has pattern noise in it, a few things like that, so that if you can, during the course of the night, if you can nudge the position that it's taking pictures on a tiny bit, when you go to stack those images, let's say you take 100 images of one target during the night, and you go to stack that in your automation software, if that one bad pixel, either a hot pixel or a cold pixel or whatever, or your pattern noise, it is all on the same position in your image, when you stack it, those hot pixels will all stack up on top of each other. If instead you tell your scope between every picture you take, you tell it, nudge just a tiny bit, well, in one frame, that hot pixel may be over the center of the galaxy that you're trying to take a picture of. In the next frame, it will be nudged slightly off. And as this process is called dithering. And as dithering progresses during the night, each frame, ideally, each frame will have that hot pixel in a slightly different location. So that when you stack it up, there is a special feature called sigma clipping in your stacking software that will make those hot pixels disappear. Because it's smart enough to know, hey, something's wrong with that particular pixel. If you don't dither, you can't really, well, if you don't dither, it's a lot harder to do that. So that's kind of an aside, not really an automation feature, but it's one of the things that your automation software has to take care of for you during the night. Like I said, slewing to the next target and parking your mount safely at the end of the night. So your automation software will send commands to the mount to handle all this stuff for you. Second component is the camera. Automation software can take a couple of approaches to this. Some automation software will actually handle the capture of it. It'll have its own image capture routine in it. So you program it and you tell it, I want to take this many pictures, this way, something like that. Other automation software will at least allow you to use third-party capture software. But either way, your automation software acts as the interface between the pictures you want to take and your hardware. And what it does, as far as the camera goes, the automation software will send start and stop commands to it during the night. You will have told it in advance how you want to handle exposure time, binning, how you want to cool the camera, the gain on the camera. The automation software will also tell it, you know, when it's time to take flats. If you're taking darks or biases, it'll tell it that stuff too. So there are just like with the mount, there are a number of commands that it sends to the camera during the night. Auto-guiding, that may seem kind of self-evident that your auto-guider is running during the night. But they're, again, just like the other two components, they're actually points where your automation software intervenes during the night. So, for example, if you're slewing from one target to the other, you can't auto-guide during that time. So the automation software shuts down your auto-guider.
Auto-guider gets really upset when it does that.
Right. It would get very annoyed with you if you tried to continue auto-guiding while you're slewing across the sky.
I've done that.
But what it does is it will, so I use PhD to auto-guide, and what it will do will be to shut PhD down, slew the scope across the sky to your next target, and once it's found the target, then it turns PhD back on. It will actually look for a guide star automatically within the field that your guide camera is looking at, pick out the best guide star for you, and pick up auto-guiding again. And then once auto-guiding has settled down and the scope is happily tracking again, then it'll start your pictures on your next target. What else does it do?
And it knows when the scope is happy.
Yeah, so what you do, and again, I'll show you this when I show you sequence generator. It looks at the PhD graph, right? So it looks at the feedback that it's getting from your auto-guider. And when it says, okay, you know, I am now happy, I can see auto-guiding has taken off, it's all running, it'll wait until that point. That's called settling. It waits for your auto-guiding to settle before it turns on the camera. Because otherwise, you know, if it just found the star, you know, the star could be out, PhD could be still trying to drag your scope back into the right point to get the star on target. It actually waits until it sees that your auto-guider has got things under control before it starts taking the next picture. Auto-focusing. We'll talk in a little bit about how auto-focusing works, but you know, if you've ever adjusted the focus on your telescope, you can see that the star that you're trying to use is particularly, if you're using an off-axis guider the way I do, if you change the focus, well, the focus of the star that your auto-guider is looking at is also going in and out of focus. And so you can tell the automation software to shut off auto-guiding while you're doing your focusing run. I actually don't do that, and I'll explain to you why in a little bit. It gives you the option of whether you want to do that or not. But that's one, again, that's another potential command that it needs to deal with the auto-guider during the night. And then at the end of the session, obviously, it shuts off auto-guiding when it's ready to park your mount. And if I didn't say this, anybody has questions while we go on, you know, feel free to ask, all right? Next component is the filter wheel. And, you know, basically, this was like step two for me. The first thing I really wanted to get into was I want my scope to be parked and safe at the end of the night, right? But then for planetary imaging, I had already gone ahead and gotten an electronic filter wheel. And just because when you're changing filters in planetary imaging, time is really of the essence, right? So I already had it, and I said, well, you know, as long as I've got this thing, is there any reason that my automation software can't put my filters in place for me during the night? And the answer is no. The automation software is happy to do that for you, and that's what it does. So if I'm taking luminance, red, green, and blue on a particular target during the night, automation software does all that for you. You know, tell it you want to do an hour for each color, do an hour for luminance, it'll rotate your next filter into place, do an hour for red, hour for green, and it'll take care of all that for you. So it'll do your luminance for you, and it's already focused, and then it'll put your red filter in place. And if you have played with filters at all, you realize that you almost always have to adjust focus between your filters. And your automation software, actually, you can, once you've figured this out in advance, you know what are called your filter offsets, which means my focus position is slightly different between my luminance filter, my red filter, my green filter, my blue filter. For me, actually, my luminance, red and green, are close enough to par focal, but my blue filter definitely needs to be adjusted for focusing. And you have programmed this in advance, and this is just a one-time thing, you don't need to do it each night. You've told your automation software in advance, this is how much offset I need in between my filters. And so when it rotates that blue filter into place, it looks at the position for the autofocuser and says, okay, I need to nudge it in a little bit, moves it into the right place, and your set takes up, starts imaging again. Another feature is that if you guys have worked with flats, did you guys who do imaging, do you use monochrome cameras? Okay, well, so the deal that you'll find is I've got four different filters, right? Luminance, red, green, and blue. And if I'm using a plain old ordinary light bulb to light up the flat panel that I want to use for my flat frames, that panel is white, and it's at a certain brightness, right? Because, you know, the light bulbs are what they are, right? So the luminance filter is taking, you know, basically all of that light and sending it through to the camera. The red filter is only taking the red light. The green is only taking the green, blue is only taking the blue, and the light bulb that you're using, you know, may be a yellowish bulb, it may be a bluish bulb. So what you'll find is that your flats need to be different exposure times for different colors. And again, this is something that you've told your program in advance. So it knows, for example, for me, it knows that it needs 12-second exposures for flats for one of my filters. It needs 5-second exposures for flats for another one of my filters. And that's all programmed into it in advance. Again, a one-time thing, and it's done.
Pardon my ignorance, but how do you decide how much time to give to a particular flat on a particular color?
You messed with it in advance. Again, this is a one-time thing, and again, whether you're doing automation or not, you need to know this stuff. It has to be done.
For a certain amount of saturation in the histogram?
Yeah, what you're trying to do in general is you're trying to put the peak of the histogram at the middle, right? So if your camera has a if your camera has an ADU, if it's a 16-bit camera, it can go from zero, black, up to 64,000, whatever, white, right? And you want the peak of your histogram to be about 30,000. Now, I've said that you set all that up in advance and you do it all yourself, but in fact, automation software like Sequence Generator has a tool in it that will let you point your telescope at your flat panel with your lights on. It will rotate through all your filters for you. It'll do all the calculations. It'll take test images. It'll figure out, okay, where do I have the peak at 30,000? It will record all that information for you in Sequence Generator so that, you know, a month from now, when you set up a sequence and you say, okay, at the end of the night, I want you to take flats using, you know, filters, use my S2 filter, my HA filter, my O3 filter, and I'm going to be binned 2x2 on one of those filters and 1x1 on the other two filters. It's got all that information down already. So when you tell it, take these flats, it says, yes, master, I know what to do now. And it puts all that information into your sequence for you. So it is a big time saver.
But you have to go through and create essentially a profile at least once.
That's right. You have to profile your system.
Okay.
Although, I guess this is what I'm saying. It will pretty much profile your system for you. So that, you know, again, another advantage of the automation software. But again, that's something that you only need to do once. Until you get the new camera, until you replace your filters. Yeah. Okay, so once for any particular setup, right? Replace your light bulbs and, you know, your flat panel, you know, all that sort of stuff. But the advantage is that, you know, then you turn on Sequence Generator and you say, okay, I changed something, figure it out for me all over again, right? Last component is the autofocuser. And this is the second coolest thing that I think that automation software does. The way I first looked at this and I said, can't. I mean, that how can your computer? I mean, I know that I paid Canon to have autofocusing in my digital camera, right? So there must be a way that it can be done. But when people first started talking about autofocusing, I said, how? I mean, how can that possibly work? And I will actually show you in a minute here how it works. It's once you understand it, then it actually makes sense. But again, this is something that changes during the night. As each filter is rotated into place, you're going to need the focusing adjusted. For what I do is I actually have it do a focus and an autofocusing run each time I put a new filter into place. You really can't go, even if your temperature doesn't change, you really can't go 8-10 hours without refocusing your telescope. I mean, there's a lot of things that cause your telescope to lose focus during the night. I have a Schmidt-Cassegrain, and so one of those things is that the mirror, you know, which is a giant block of glass, shifts a little bit during the night. So even if it is, you know, 52 degrees from dusk to dawn, there are still other things that make that focus change during the night. So as a matter of convenience, you can do this any way you want. You can tell the autofocuser, look, I want you to do a focusing run every hour. I want you to do a focusing run when the temperature changes by 2 degrees. I want you to do a focusing run when I change filters, when I slew to a new target. You know, there's all sorts of things that you can do. But it does do, it gives you all these options, and it will do these, it will run these focus, it'll do these autofocus runs during the night for you. The second thing that I've got here is focuser backlash. If you guys have high-end focusers, unlike mine, you probably don't run into this. But I use the stock focuser on my Schmidt-Cassegrain. And the stock focusers are notorious for backlash. I mean, that may be true on any kind of telescope, you know, other than the high-end telescopes. But you know, stock focusers, what backlash means is, I'm focusing this direction, right? And I'm watching the focus, and I just went past focus. I saw it, but I moved past focus. So now I got to change direction and push my focuser back in. The trick is that there's slack in that focuser. And so I actually might have to rotate, you know, half a turn before the focus actually starts to change again. That's backlash. Your autofocuser knows that because you've told it in advance, I want you to always approach focus from one direction. You know, once you've figured out what focus is, I need you to take all this stuff into account. So the autofocus program, your automation software, already knows how to deal with backlash, and it will run that for you during the night. Last thing is that the autoguider will actually settle, because for me, I actually continue autoguiding while I'm doing an autofocus run. You don't have to do that. Some people prefer not to. But the autofocuser will, again, it'll wait for the scope to settle. So if it starts an autofocusing run, it's not just going to do it blindly. It wants to make sure that your guider is happy and your telescope is staying on target while it does this. Let me show you how this actually works. So your system actually is able to compare images from the stars. What happens is that you've either told your automation software, you know, you just use the star field that I'm taking pictures of right now to do your focusing, or for some software you can actually tell it, you know, slew to Altair and use Altair as a single star for my focusing target. But either way, what it's doing is it looks at the stars in your picture. Let me back up. When it starts an autofocusing run, it takes one picture with your camera, usually, you know, short exposure. I have either 15 or 30 seconds, depending on what filters I've got in place. It'll take that picture, and then it looks at the stars in the picture, and it does it calculates the diameter of those stars in the picture. That's it. Can use a couple different tools for that. It's full width, half maximum, half flux radius. I don't really know what they mean, except that if you think of like a cross section through your stars, you know, you see blackness here, it's dark here, and then you've got a sharp peak where your star is, and then blackness on the other side, right? And what it does is it looks at how tight those peaks are. And so it takes one exposure, measures the sharpness of all your stars, nudges your focuser in a tiny bit, takes another picture, compares the sharpness of those stars. And what it'll do is it'll create this chart, it'll create this graph. This is focus position across the bottom. My focuser has up to 100,000 steps, they're called. It keeps track of each of these focus positions, and it keeps track of the half-flux radius as it goes through this focusing run. And it creates this graph, which is called a V-curve. Usually they look, and ideally you want them to look more like U-curves than V-curves. But what it does is it generates this curve, then there's an algorithm that it runs that forces it onto a real curve, and it figures out from that, best focus is down here somewhere. And that corresponds with the focuser position of whatever it is. So it goes through this run, figures out your best focus, sets your focuser, waits for your autoguider to settle again, and then starts up taking the next picture. That's your focus run. And it may do that several times during the night.
If you're taking 15 to 30 second exposures, though, that can take 7 minutes, can't it?
That's true. An autofocus run will, you know, for me it takes a good 5 minutes. Because, in between the time it takes to compensate for backflash, the time it takes to actually capture the images, the time it takes for the autoguider to settle in between those images, you know, all of those things add some time to it. So, you know, it could take 5, and with narrowband images, you know, it can take 7 minutes. But on the other hand, I'm only doing an autofocus run, you know, 4, 5, 6 times a night. So yeah, you do lose some imaging time to autofocus. On the other hand, you would lose the whole session to blurry stars otherwise, right?
And you're asleep.
Well, yeah, and I'm not there while it's doing all this, right? So this is actually the coolest feature. I said autofocusing was the second coolest feature. Plate solving to me is the coolest feature. And it's not a hardware thing. There's actually not really a piece of hardware that goes along with this. The question here is, how does your, if I'm going to slew at multiple targets during the night, and if I start off just pointing at a random patch of sky, and then I go inside, how does the telescope know where the target is? How does it know when it's got the target, right? And what it does is plate solving. Some of you guys may have run into this before in other ways. But in short, what it does is it takes a picture of the star field that it's looking at right now, figures out where the stars are in there, and then looks at all the angles between the stars and creates a data set of those angles. Goes into its own database and looks for those angles in its database. You can tweak it a little bit. You can give it a little information that'll make this process faster. But in short, what it's doing is it's comparing your picture to its database of star fields. And it figures out from there exactly where it's pointing at. And it uses that information and the information that you've entered for what target you want to shoot next to figure out, okay, right now I'm at 16 hours RA and 10 degrees deck. I want to slew over to 19 and a half hours RA and minus 12 degrees deck, right? It takes the first picture, figures out where it is, tells the telescope to slew that amount, takes the second picture, figures out where it is, and if it's not quite on target, if it's not quite on target, it'll nudge. Do basically for my system, it just does another slew, although it's a tiny slew, right? Because it's only going, a couple of arcnets. Takes another picture until it finally says, okay, I'm close enough. And what I've done is I set a parameter in advance of I think 100 arc seconds that I want it to be. And it'll do a number of, it'll do however many slews you tell it to do before it finally says, either I've got it or I'm giving up and I'm parking the scope and going to sleep tonight.
So that's in the sequence generator pro?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. It is, now, I'm saying it's in Sequence Generator Pro, but it's actually not in the automation software. The automation software interfaces with plate solving software.
Oh.
And so it's something that you have to add on, but it's freeware. I use a program called Elbrus. Elbrus, E-L-B-R-U-S. And again, I'll show it to you when I walk you through sequence generator here. It's freeware. I back it up with astrometry.net, which is actually an internet-based service, but you can install their database on your computer. And the reason I say I back it up is because Elbrus, I find, fails about one time in four. I don't really know why, but plate solving is only so accurate, right? And so I use what's called a failover, which it fails over to astrometry.net. And I have, in between the two of them, I have never had a problem getting plate solving to work. Or, okay, when I have had a problem getting plate solver to work, it's user error, it's not plate solving.
What was the name of the second site?
Was astrometry.net. It's actually a web-based service. If you can send an image to them and they'll solve it for you, tell you what your imaging scale is, you know, what the size of your picture is. So like if you've got new software or new hardware that you want to characterize, you've got a new camera, or I mean even if you change any of your components. Anytime I change my components, I do this. I take a picture, send it to astrometry, and they tell me, you know, my scale on arc seconds per pixel. They tell me the width of my field, everything like that. And because that's information that, you know, when you're running automation software, you really need to know. So, to me, that's the coolest thing, because that's what makes capturing multiple targets during a night without user intervention possible. Because the scope has to know where it is. And you know your telescope may have great go-tos, but they're not good enough for this. I have a CPC, which is it's a mid-range mount. It's not known for being genius at its go-tos, but using plate solving software, I can get slews accurate to within about 10 arc seconds. And for deep sky photography, you know, I've got a 20 arc minute by 30 arc minute field. 10 arc seconds accuracy is just fine. Last feature I want to talk about, we've actually talked about this a bit, is flats. What I told you is that I have sequence generator programmed to park my telescope at the end of the night and then take flats after my lamps come on and illuminate my panel at the back of my observatory. There's a second way to do this, which is what CCD Autopilot does. That's an alternative to sequence generator. And what you do is you... what the software will do will be, at a certain time in the morning, as dusk is coming up, it'll point at the sky for you. It will measure the sky brightness for you. It'll take another exposure and measure how much the sky has brightened in between the two exposures. And then, using the information that you've already given it about what exposure times you need to get proper flats, it will calculate how much the sky is going to brighten during your flat run. And if you tell it I want to take 25 flats, it'll be taking longer exposures for flat number one than for flat number 25. And it's done that calculation because it measured how rapidly the sky was brightening. Now, I don't do that because I'm imaging from an observatory and I don't need to. But it is a significant convenience to be able to do that when you're out in the field like this. I think we've talked about most of this. Like I said, I use the flat panel, and I use a timer that turns it on. And for a permanent setup, that's fine. So these are the different options for automation software. I will, by the way, at the end of this, I'll tell you where you guys can find my presentation online. And I've given you links here to all of the different automation packages that I know about. And you can spend as much money as you want on automation software. Automation started off from ACP. These are the guys who really started the ball rolling about 10, 12 years ago. And it pretty much is the gold standard. If you on the web, if you come across these guys who have remotely controlled observatories down in Australia, ACP is almost certainly what they're using to open that observatory up and run it during the night. It will do everything from, you know, opening your roof for you, closing your roof for you, all that sort of stuff, which is why it can cost up to $5,000. Second option, which a lot of people use and was probably the kind of the mainstream program until the last couple of years, is CCD Autopilot. A couple other options are CCD Commander and this fairly new program called MaxFloat. You can see that they range from free up to $300, but the deal with all three of those programs is that, at least to my knowledge, all of them require MaxMDL to actually handle capturing and handle interfacing between the hardware. And MaxMDL is almost a $500 program. So you know, these programs may not be super expensive on their own, but you know, when you throw in Maxim on top of it for an extra $500, you know, that adds a fair chunk of change to the process. And so, as you know, what I did was sequence generator. Sequence generator, really $99 is your only investment in software here, because it guides with PhD guiding, which is, and there's a couple other freeware programs that it could use for guiding as well. But it guides with PhD, which is free. It uses ASCOM as the communications interface between the different pieces of hardware, also free. So your real investment here really is only $99. And when I got into this, and all I really wanted to do was park my scope, it was actually on its freeware trial at that point. They hadn't actually, you know, created they hadn't decided to advance the program and add the new features to it and create a pay version for it. So it was a great way for me, when all I wanted to do was park the scope, was to start working with it as freeware. But now it is only $99. There are actually some advanced capabilities beyond this that we haven't even gotten into, that they charge they sell as modules, add-on modules, for I think $30-$40 each. You can happily go for years with what's in the basic $99 package. That's pretty much all I had. I was gonna just set up sequence generator for you on my other laptop and walk you through setting up a sequence and what it actually does during the night. While I'm doing that, if anybody has any questions, this would probably be a good time to throw anything out there. No, it's all clear? Excellent.
Did you say one of those programs is only for the Mac?
I don't think so.
Okay.
As far as I know, all of those programs are PC-based. If they have a Mac version too, that would be more the question.
Okay.
Sequence generator does not. Sequence generator is PC only. I guess that's probably true of the other ones. Maxim.
So you're using sequence generator program is out here.
Say that again, I'm sorry.
Sequence generator program is getting your mount ASCOM commands to control, is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, ASCOM is more just it's a communications protocol. I mean, honestly, I'll tell you, I don't really know how ASCOM works and what it really does.
You don't have to.
But that's the whole point. You don't have to. You know, once you've got it set up and running, and again, you know, it can require some tweaking, but once you've got it set up and running, you're done. You're golden. And there's nothing extra that you have to do. And I'll say that Chris Todd helped me get this running last night and has been generous enough to let me use his Mac during this presentation. So you can blame him if anything goes wrong in this process here.
Does the software you use require an auto guider as well, or can it just work straight with your mount?
No, I mean, plate solving actually doesn't have anything to do with your auto guider. It uses your imaging, your main camera to take its plate solve pictures.
Because
that's what you're interested in. You want to make sure your main camera is pointed in the right place.
Okay.
Now, that said, I actually will send my auto-guiding images into astrometry.net to be solved if I change my setup, because I want to know exactly how far away from my main field of view my auto-guider field of view is, so that I can pre-target my guide stars with off-axis guides. But that's really the only thing I do with it. So Chris, you want to remind me how I... share this. I thought it was already set up for sharing, but I think I just have to wake up the projector here.
Go to settings, control panel, displays.
Yep.
Settings. Okay. To extend my desktop.
Okay.
You gotta drag everything off the right side of your screen.
So this is requiring a little bit of sleight of hand on my point of view. My point of view, I think I can get it all to happily work. Let me just resize my windows first. Okay, so this is a sequence generator here. And what I want to show you is I'll walk through the how you actually set up a sequence and show you what this particular sequence that I've got set up is going to do during the night. So the sequence that I'm using is a three-target sequence plus flats at the end of the night. You've got a toolbar up here that has pretty much everything you want. These windows that I've got here are opened up by the toolbar. But they're basically just showing you information about the pictures as they come in. I don't have a live picture here, so you can't see something, but like your histograms are going to show here. You can actually look at PHD through this little window here, see what filters you've got set here, or select your filters through this window. Shows you the temperature of your camera. You can nudge your telescope if you want. I never use this, but if you want, you can nudge the position of your telescope, and it'll tell you exactly where your telescope is pointing at any given time. This is what I use. This frame and focus is what I use when I want to do rough focus during the night. So I started taking test exposures, and then I nudge focusing until I get it roughly correct. I'm not sure that I finished that loop. The reason that you don't have to do precise focusing at the beginning of the night is that once you hit the go button, basically it'll do an autofocus run for you, and it'll refine your focus and get it for you. For a sequence generator, you have to get it kind of roughly in focus. You can't have it a million miles out of focus. My understanding is that for certainly for ACP and for CCD autopilot, you actually can have it a million miles out of focus because there is a third program called RoboFocus, which will... I'm not using the right term here. It's not RoboFocus, it's the hardware. Focus Max, that's what I'm thinking. There's a third-party program called Focus Max, which is freeware, but which, guess what, requires MaxHDL. So, again, the reason I don't use it, right? Rough focus for me is easy enough. All you have to do is look at a couple pictures that come back from your camera, figure that's good enough, and press the start button, and it'll take over from there.
You don't see any issue with the plate solving because the star size potentially could affect the plate solving.
Yeah. So if you are the first thing you're with sequence generator, the first thing that's going to happen when you hit run sequence, which is by the way, in this panel over here, you just when you're ready, you just hit run sequence and it takes over. The first thing it's going to do is an autofocus run.
Okay.
So or at least you can set it up that way, and I certainly do. Right, and once you've got your autofocusing set up, from there on during the night, everything is going to be in focus for you. If it does a slew to another target and changes filters for you, let me show you this. Let's walk through the different panels. As soon as I slew it over the frame. When you're setting up your system in advance, there's a bunch of different, these are basically the pieces of hardware that we walked through at the beginning, right? There's a window for your camera, and you can set up whatever you want. You can tell it, I want to cool, all I've really done here is I tell it, I want to cool down to 0 degrees over a 2-minute period, and when I'm finished, just go ahead and warm the camera up to 20 degrees or whatever the ambient temperature is when I'm done. That's pretty much all that's in here. Except for this. This is plate solving. And what I've done is, because I sent it into astrometry.net, I know my imaging scale is 0.57 arc seconds per pixel. And I've entered that number in here in advance. We'll come back to plate solving in a minute here, but that scale is all you need to tell it in advance.
What's the angle part mean?
What's that?
What's the angle part?
Position that, of the camera.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh.
It's the position of the field, but that's going to calculate for you.
Okay.
At this point, all you need to know is what is my imaging scale. In theory, you don't need to know that. It can do something called blind solving, but it'll just make life a lot easier for you. And it's so easy to figure out what your scale is, as long as you've taken a picture and sent it to astrometry.net. 5 minutes later, they'll come back with an image for you, and they'll tell you what your scale is and how big your field is and stuff like that.
That's not fixed by the manufacturer, I mean, by the CCD size itself.
Well, but remember, if I change my hardware, I mean, it's set in microns, you know, it's 4.5 microns per pixel, right?
Yeah.
But if I change my hardware, my scale is going to change.
Right.
So, like, for example, when I switched my off-axis guider a few weeks ago, I went from 0.59 to 0.57 arc seconds per pixel.
Okay.
And because I want my plate solves to be fast, that's what's important, and I failed the plate solve. And I couldn't figure out why, and the reason was because I had told it my imaging scale is 0.59 arc seconds per pixel with 1% error buffer on either side. That's not enough to get you down to 0.57 arc seconds per pixel, right? So like I said, you know, yeah, it works fine except for user error.
So is it doing the plate solve with the auto guider or with the main camera?
With the main camera. Yeah, because what you're interested in is, do I have the target I want
right,
in my main camera, right?
Okay.
The only reason I ever do a plate solve for astrometry.net with my off-axis guider is because I want to know, if I change my hardware,
mm-hmm.
I take a picture with my main camera and a picture with my off-axis guider at the same time. I send them both into astrometer.net, and from there I can figure out what my offset is between my off-axis guider field of view and my main camera field of view.
Okay.
And if you want to pre-plan your guide stars with planetarium software, you got to know that offset.
Oh.
You've heard everybody tell you how hard it is to use an off-axis guider because you can't find stars.
Mm-hmm.
If you know your field of view and you know where it is, all you do is you rotate your off-axis guider in advance to where you know a guide star will be.
Okay.
So, but otherwise, that's really the only time I'm doing it. Next box here is controls your filter wheel. And you can manually pick a filter that you want here. I never need to do this because the system is programmed. They'll pick your filters for you. But here is where you feed in some information about your filters. So I know the difference in focus positions. These are like absolute focus positions, which is important to know. But the real key is, like, for example, how different is my S2 filter from my H-alpha filter? How different is my blue filter from my red filter? And all that information here is programmed in advance because that is the one-time programming that you need to give this thing. The information about how long my flats should be for each filter. I'm a bit too lazy yet to do it from LRGB, but that's programmed here in advance. And when you did that setup run with sequence generator, it programmed all that information in here for you, and it'll store it for you. And this is where you find it. There's one thing I forgot about autofocusing, which is the type of autofocuser you need. If you really want to do automated imaging, you need an absolute focuser, as opposed to a relative focuser. What absolute focusing means is that there is a hardware chip, whatever, inside the focus motor that keeps track of exactly where that focus motor is. And so you see these numerical positions here at focus point. My focuser will run from, as far as I know, it keeps track of numbers from 0 to 100,000. So if I change the focus, like if I go from, I know the computer can send a command to it to move to 57,002, right? And it knows exactly where that is with its motor. When I change focus, it goes to, you know, 56,930, and it knows where it is. A relative focuser does not know that. A relative focuser knows, hey, I want to run my motor for 1/4 of a second. I want to run my motor for 3 seconds.
Number of steps.
Right. It doesn't know exactly whether, it doesn't know whether it succeeded.
Right.
So you can guess, if I run the motor, if I send a command to run the motor for 1 second, it'll move 100 steps. But they're not that accurate. So eventually, you're going to wind up way out of whack. And the difference in price between an absolute focuser and what you're looking for here is something called a stepper motor. A DC motor is going to lead you to a relative focuser, which you don't want. The difference in cost is small. I think it was $50, something like that. And you know, given that even these little manual hand control electric focusers that you're going to plug into your telescope are going to cost $175, you know, that it's not that much more money to get an absolute focuser. So I guess my advice, what I'm trying to say is that if you're adding electric focusing to your telescope, spend the extra money to get an absolute focuser. Because you'll find, even if you're not doing automation, you'll find it's really helpful to know, oh, I just saw it. My focus position is 70,000, as opposed to my focus position was 3.5 seconds ago as I was going through it. If you can tell your machine, you know, whether you're doing imaging or not, if you're, you know, if you're just trying to get back to good focus, if you know, well, when I was comparing focus points, the best one looked like it was 70,000. You tell your focuser, go to 70,000, as opposed to, man, I got to figure this all out over again. It's worth spending the extra money just to get an absolute focuser with a stepper motor up front.
So from at that and then at that point in time, you then go through your focus loop to get the precise focus.
Yeah, well, when the autofocuser takes up, it knows because it knows the motor is telling it, I am at 70,000 now, I am at 69,000 now, I'm at 68,000 now, and it generates that V curve that we talked about to look at, you know, how, when do I, what position am I at when I'm at sharpest focus.
So this gets it close and then that gets it precise.
No, I have eyeballed it. So what this is, these numbers here are programmed in advance, right? But if the temperature, I program these at a certain temperature, let's say, you know, 50 degrees, right? So if I go out in the middle of winter and it's minus 10 degrees, these numbers actually aren't going to be right anymore. So which is why I have to actually go through it and do a manual, you know, and roughly focus it manually, right? And so it may be that my focus for 50 degrees Fahrenheit is 57,000, but my focus for minus 10 degrees Fahrenheit may be, you know, 49,000, right? But what's important about this is it knows the difference between this filter and that filter, or between this filter and that filter. And if it knows the difference is, say, you know, 200 steps, if my focus position that I've settled on is 40,000 rather than 70,000, it offsets 200 steps from 40,000. So yeah, it does keep these numbers in its memory, but what it's really interested in is the difference between any two of these filters. Because it knows, when you do your rough focusing, you've told it in advance, okay, I'm using my luminance filter to focus, right? And when you focus it for 40,000, it knows, okay, I gotta offset all my filters by that amount. It keeps track of all that for it.
So the offset stays the same no matter what the change?
Yeah, you know, I guess in theory the offset itself could change.
I would bet it would.
I've never run into it though. Okay. But it wouldn't surprise me. So, you know, if you do your filter setup in, you know, August, you may want to check it again in January and see if your offsets are the same. I haven't done that yet, but that's probably a worthwhile activity to see if you want to have, you know, a summer and a winter setting for your offsets. So let me just show you the last couple of things here. These are the other pieces of hardware that you're controlling up here. Your focuser is here. I use autofocusing, so that's what this means. And when you go into this window, it gives you all the options. So I want to do an autofocus run every time you get a 2 degree temperature change. You can set it up to, you know, to autofocus every, you know, every hour, every 2 hours. I also do an autofocus run when I change filters, and I do an autofocus run before the sequence starts. So that's what we were talking about, that you do rough focusing, and then when you hit run sequence and you go inside and go to bed, it actually will do an accurate focus for you before it starts taking pictures.
And then it does relative, well actually you're doing it on each filter change.
So yes, yes. In theory, I could say, oh, I'm so good at this that I don't need to do an autofocus run, and it'll just do filter offsets every time it puts a new filter in place. But like I said, your focus is going to change during the night anyway, so it's not going to hurt you to do an autofocus run, you know, 3, 4, 5 times a night.
Does this keep a log file so that you can look at what
yes.
actually determined its settings were?
Absolutely. And when you are trying to troubleshoot your hardware problems, you're going to spend time looking through that log file to find out what went wrong. Yeah, it keeps an excellent log. It is very helpful. And the reason it keeps a log is because Jared and Ken, the guys who wrote Sequence Generator, they want to know why their hardware isn't working either. So, you know, this is what I like about this program, that, like, there's two guys who are suffering through the same things that you are. And, you know, they have a Yahoo group, and, you know, they answer questions. You know, I have, from the peanut gallery, I've said to them, hey, maybe you could add, like, the backlash compensation and focusers. I asked them if they could add that in about a year ago. And they said, yeah, that makes sense. And they added it in. So, you know, they are very responsive. Next block, hardware, is the telescope. All I really do here is I tell it to park the telescope at the end of the night when I'm done. Your plate solving setup is in here. As I said, I use Elbrus as my plate solver. And see this thing, use blind solver failover. That means that when Elbrus fails, it goes over to astrometry.net as a backup. I will say that Elbrus and astrometry.net, they're a little tricky to set up. And it does take some thinking. But once they're done, you will never have to touch them again. They're finished. And you can definitely get help from the guys on the Sequence Generator Yahoo group. They will walk you through it. Auto guiding settings are in this box here. I've told it to. I'm using PhD. You'll see it can run with a couple other auto guiding programs as well. I've told it I want to dither. There's actually a range of dithering settings, which I won't go through here because dithering is kind of an art in and of itself. I've told it to obviously stop auto-guiding when the sequence is done. I've told it to settle the auto-guider, which means make sure that your guiding is accurate and is under control before you begin your autofocus frames. No, I don't see it here because they've moved it. I don't use it, but we had talked about flats. I have my flats. I have a panel, and I have lights that turn on. There is another way that you can do this, which is called a flat man, which is a
filter.
No, it's a it's an electroluminescent panel, and so I don't have one of these things because flat mans they come from Alnitak systems. They cost a fortune for a big telescope. But what it is rather than having a piece of foam core that you've cut out with an X-Acto knife and stapled into the back of your observatory that's lit up by two incandescent bulbs that might be similar but probably aren't and don't always glow the same way, you can use an electroluminescent panel, which is, the whole point of the electroluminescent panel is that every pixel in it is the same brightness across the entire screen. And that's the purpose of your flats. Sequence Generator can actually work with that. You could program it in advance, so it will turn on the panel for you in advance. It'll run it at certain brightnesses, depending on what filters you're using. So it does have a whole bunch of features for that. It used to be right here, and they have now added it in up here. And since I don't use it, I don't know exactly where it is. But the last thing I want to do is just walk you through a sequence. This is one that I used just recently. So this box up here is where you set up your sequence. So the target list, these are each of my targets. I used this a couple of weeks ago. The Wizard Nebula, M7, so this is a series of planetary nebulae through the late summer, early fall. The Wizard Nebula is not a planetary, take it back. The Wizard Nebula, M76, the little dumbbell, and NGC 1501, which is way up north, a little planetary. And then flats. So this is the first frame here is the wizard, and what you can see what I've set it up to do is to take a series of H alpha images. So it will put my H alpha image, my H alpha filter in place. Takes 1,200 second, 20 minute exposures. Camera's binned one by one. It's going to take 11 of those pictures. And up here, kind of hard for me to snag it. These are the settings for the Wizard Nebula. So it, I've set it in RA. This is in decimals, but you can open up this box and set, you know, hours, minutes, seconds. I've told it the position I want it to go to for the Wizard Nebula. RA depth. I told it I want it to start at 9:46 p.m. I told it I want it to finish at 12:15 a.m. And I've set it to center as soon as, you know, in other words, as soon as 9:46 comes along, it will center on these coordinates. Then, once the wizard is finished, the telescope will start on M76, and it's going to take H alpha and O3 images, 5 minutes each, for M76. It will slew to these coordinates for M76 let me show you. I told the Wizard Nebula to finish at 12:20, but it's not gonna start a new frame because it's doing 20 minute frames. It's not gonna start a new frame at 12:19. It knows better than that. So I overlap these start times by a little bit with the end time of the previous one. So in theory, the M76 will start at 5 minutes after midnight and will run until 3 o'clock in the morning. It will slew to M76 at 5 minutes after midnight, and we'll start taking these images. Then, when it finishes with M76, it will go to NGC 1501 at these coordinates, starting at 2:50 in the morning, and you can be pretty sure I'm asleep by this time, right? And it will run NGC 1501 till 5:25 in the morning. And at 5:25, just happens to be the time that my timer is set for my flat lamp to come on. So at 5:25, it will be finished with NGC 1501. My timer will go off, my lamp will turn on, it'll light up the flat panel at the back of my observatory. The flats will start at 5:28 because I want my light bulbs to actually have a chance to warm up to get to full brightness, right? So my flats will start capturing 5:28. I'm only taking 25 of them, so they will finish long before 6 a.m., but just, you know, as a matter of security. And what I've told it to do, there's a little setting here, which is I've told it that I want it to park the telescope as a pre-event option. So the flats are an event. Each of these targets is an event, and the flats is one of those events. And before I start, I've told it I want you to make sure that the telescope is parked, because otherwise it's not going to be pointing at the flat panel, right? So it parks the telescope. Once it's there, it starts the HA exposures. It already knows, because it's programmed in advance, those exposures are 5 minutes. So, for example, if I wanted to add another set of series of flats, let me show you here, I can say I want to take a flat with my S2 filter. And it already knows that requires a 10.22 second exposure. You always want 25 flats because that's what I've told it in advance, and these ones are going to be binned one by one. So it's very convenient. It has all its stuff in its memory and it'll do it all for you. But this, the flats that I programmed, it'll take H alpha flats, it'll rotate the O3 filter into place, and it'll take O3 flats as well. Then it will basically put the scope to sleep for the night. It'll stop it from tracking, so it doesn't keep. Oh, well, that's what parking does. It stopped tracking, it's pointed in one position, and it's safe from passing birds and from mist dropping out of the tulip poplars. So this looks terribly complicated, but the security that you guys have is that if I can figure out how to get this thing running, you guys definitely can figure out how to get it running. And there is the Yahoo group, and there's me on the NOVAC listserv. If you have any problems and you want to try and get this thing set up. I actually did, in the wild, the other night, I found another user on the field who was using Sequence Generator Pro, who was Ian Stewart, and is having great luck with it, too. So there are lots of people out there using it. And if you have questions, ask me. Ask the Sequence Generator Yahoo group, and it'll get up and running for you. The one thing that I would say is that, you know, if you are not imaging now, but you're upgrading your hardware, like I said, if you're looking for a focuser, go ahead and spend a small amount of extra money to get an absolute focuser with a stepper motor. If you're starting into photography and you've got a monochrome camera, don't get a manual filter wheel. Go ahead and spend the extra $150 to get an electronic filter wheel, because eventually you're going to want one. Anybody have any questions? Okay.
Great.
If you have any questions while we're here, hopefully I'll be imaging tonight. I'm up on the red field, and I am the first telescope that you'll come to on the red field. So if you want to see this up and running, and we have stars tonight, I will hopefully have it running, and I can show you how it works in real life. Okay?
Well, will you be asleep?
Will I be asleep?